So the biggest problem is that I have sore throat. So can you hear me? That's the biggest problem. So if you cannot, then just please move forward. So it's really bad. So maybe just two stage forward. So. Okay, so I'm supposed to talk on complex analysis. So I have chosen something which would be slightly interesting, and I'll show you some pictures so that you like this. So I would try to make it as entertaining as possible. So we start with what is called conformal mapping. So what is a conformal mapping? So conformal mapping is a mapping which preserves angles. So how does it work? So if you take a map, to be on safer side, I mean you can take a meromorphic function, let's think of it holomorphic functions to start with. So we have an analytic function, so differentiable in the complex sense. So holomorphic function on some domain, on some region on the complex plane. So so these regions will be usually open connected sets, or sometime we might require them to be also simply connected, so that any loop you can shrink to a point. So they will be nice looking things like a disk. So what is conformal? So if I just look at this picture, so I look at two pictures. So here I have a card, say C. And I have so I have here a point Z naught, and this is the map F. So it takes you to the image curve, say some gamma. So image of this curve under F. So F is this map, and then this point comes to F Z naught. So now I look at a small chord close to this, so Z. So from Z to, okay, so by my drawing it has become so bad that it is, that is really bad. Let's make it a more curved. So this is my point and this is my F Z. Now what is the angle here? So what is this angle? Yeah. Oh yeah, sure. Yes. But you are getting video recorded.
I know.
So what is this angle? So this angle is just the argument of the difference of these two complex numbers. And similarly, what is the angle? So, okay, so sorry about my drawing, but then what is the angle? So this is argument of that's the angle. So what is the change of angle? So So how much angle is changed? So what is the difference between these two angles? So which is the difference of these two arguments? So it is going to be z minus z naught. So that is the same as argument of this minus argument of this. So now if I take, so suppose this f prime z exists. So if the derivative exists and derivative is non-zero, then this thing will go to argument of just the f prime z. So it's important that it is non-zero, because the argument you cannot define if it is zero. So, okay. So that is the change. So the change in the angle. So if you have this condition that f is differentiable at f is analytic at z naught and the derivative is non-zero, then what is happening is that this change in the angle. This is the change. This is the change, and this change does not depend on this curve C. It just depends on the function and the point. It's just the derivative of the function at that point. So it just depends on the function and the point. So if you take two curves, and their meeting point is some z naught, some c1 and c2. So when you apply this f, then both the curves will move. Certainly both the curves will move. So that's their images. But the relative, so the angle will move. So this angle, so the angle of the tangent, angle between these tangent of these two curves will move, but change by the same amount. They just change by the same amount. So if you have something like this, then the entire thing moves, but their relative angle remains the same, because this does not depend on the curve. This just depends on the function and the derivative and the point. So such a function will preserve angles. So that's the sense we mean. So that's the definition of conformality, that it preserves the angle. In this sense, that the relative angle is not changed. So whatever angle their tangent make at these points, so if you think of these tangents, so then this angle will remain the same here. So that's a conformal mapping. That's conformal. And there is a very nice property of conformal mapping. You can easily deduce from this condition that they are locally 1-1. So maybe we see a proof of that. So how does that go? So suppose I call this omega naught is f z naught. Then I look at the function f z minus say w. So w naught is f z naught, and I'm looking at this function. So let's draw the corresponding planes. So say this is our z plane on which the f function acts, and here is our w plane where the value is. So I have this is my say z naught. Here is my w naught. So z naught So this function has a 0 at z0. So I'm looking at this function. So this function has a 0 at z0 because if z0 is equal to w0. So this function has a 0 at z0 and zeros are isolated. So we can find a curve such that some say gamma, maybe we just take a circle such that this function does not vanish on gamma, and this and there are no zeros of the function inside this disk. That's always possible because zeros are isolated. So we take such a curve. So the how is that curve? So there exists a curve such that there exists a path, or you can just take a circle such that this is say away from 0 by a quantity. So it is bigger than this. Oh. Bigger than this for all z z on gamma and inside gamma. So I mean the region inside gamma. So if you do that, okay, there is a small mistake. I don't even need to do that. So let's just take, so this holds for all z on the curve. So let's just take this condition for, because it doesn't have zero, so you can always find a positive difference from zero. So that being so, then if you take a point beta in the W plane, so this is our W plane. So if 0 less than beta less than W naught, so I take beta in a punctured circle, punctured disk around W naught of radius delta. So this is just delta, and I'm not considering W naught. So I'm taking beta in this disk with W punctured without W. So then FZ minus beta, so FZ minus beta is FZ minus W naught minus, so just by triangle inequality, so beta minus W naught, so which is positive because this is more than W, more than delta, and this is less than delta, so this is at least positive. Positive on this. So for all z on the curve. Okay. So now we look at the winding numbers of these curves. So I'm going to calculate the winding number of this gamma 1 around this beta. Oh, around W naught first. Sorry. W naught. This W naught, fixed W naught. So which is just by definition is 2 pi I dW by W minus beta. That's just the definition. And gamma 1. Say gamma 1 is the image curve. So it will be somewhere here. So this is the function f. So which is taking gamma 2, gamma 1. So now if I put W equal to fz, then what it gives is, so f dash z dz fz minus, sorry, this is W naught. This is W naught. So this will also change. This will, now I'm in the z plane. So now I'm in the z plane. So and now this by the choice of this gamma, this function, this fz minus w naught has a simple zero inside this, and it does not vanish on the curve. So you can use argument principle. So argument principle will say it's just the number of zeros. Number of zeros of this function minus the number of poles. So, and it doesn't have a pole. It's we started with an analytic function. So number of zero, and that is just only one zero, because that's by construction. So I have this is just one. So the winding number of this image curve at W naught is one, and we also so this for this we use argument principle. And now these winding numbers are constant in connected component of the curve. So how do we do that? So if we can find a small disk, maybe even smaller than this delta, which is entirely inside this inside a connected component of this this curve gamma 1. So that's what we'll do. So there exists an epsilon. So if this is very close, so if some beta is close to W by epsilon, so it's in a small disk around W naught, such then this winding number of this curve at beta is equal to the winding number of this curve at W naught, because winding number remains constant and we took such a small disk which will fit inside a connected component of the curve. So and this is one, that just we calculated just now. So this is just one. So once that is just one, so we are almost done. So if I now choose a beta, which is common to both this situation, which satisfies this as well as this, so what will happen? So if I choose a beta, so suppose beta minus W naught is less than the minimum of epsilon and delta, then what will happen? Yes, then it satisfies both these things. And if it is not this, so okay, it's not W naught. Then this the winding number at beta is 1. So now we apply it to the reverse direction. So definition dW W minus beta is 1. This is on gamma 1. So I'm again change of variable. So fz dz, f dash dz, fz minus beta is 1. And for z on this curve, that this integral is on this curve, this gamma. So for z in gamma, this function fz minus beta does not have a 0. This is away from 0. So this is away from 0. And since beta also satisfies this condition, so this function does not have a 0 on this curve. So you can use argument principle again. implies, and by this condition of beta, that fz, this is not 0, this is not 0. This is not 0 on the curve. Because that is crucial. If there is a 0 on the curve, then you cannot use argument principle. So that is just 1. So this is just the number of 0 minus the number of pole. There is no pole. So we are dealing with analytic functions. So there is a simple 0. There is a simple 0. So if z minus beta has a simple 0, So this proves that it is 1-1 in that small disk. So whatever beta we take in that small disk, it takes that value in that small. So this is the small. So we found a small disk around W naught where beta takes every value exactly once. So if z is locally 1-1, this becomes 0. Exactly once, just a simple 0. So that's going to imply that f is 1-1. But of course, locally, in a small disk. And from this proof, I won't go to the. I've almost proved that. So you can also prove that. Just a few line more, this map is also an open map. So the conformal mapping, what it's doing, it's giving you a local homeomorphism. So it's giving you a local homeomorphism. It's an open 1-1 continuous map, of course. So it's giving a local homeomorphism. So let's move to some more interesting things. So I'll just start by defining a function. I will be looking at this complex plane with an infinity attached to it. So I would be denoting that by C hat. So it's our standard complex plane with infinity. So this is the one point compactification of the complex plane, which is the Riemann sphere. So that's a very standard picture, though, that you have this complex plane and you have Okay, so you have a sphere.
Very bad actually.
So this is supposed to be the pole. And so for every point on the complex plane, you just take a straight line joining these two. It will cut your sphere at a point, and that's the image. So you have a big sphere sitting on a plane, and then you can map every point of the plane onto the sphere by this, just by take a straight line joining that point and the north pole of the sphere, so to say, and it will intersect the sphere at a point, and that's the image. So by that, every point of the plane you can map onto the sphere except for this point, and that's the point of infinity. So it's like just rolling up the entire plane on a sphere. And then there is one point remaining, and that's our point of infinity, and then we get a compact space. That's a compact space. So that's what. So we'll go back and forth from this picture. So this is called Riemann sphere, and this is the stereographic projection that you already know very much. So So I define a function on this, so which is called Mobius transform. So Mobius, to give a Mobius transform, you need four complex numbers to start with, A, B, C, D, complex numbers. And then you have to define this map. So say AZ, usually it's defined like this. So there are several things to define, because I want to define this A on this C hat to C hat. So I want to define it on the extended complex plane. So first of all, this is the definition. If there is no problem, so that's the definition. Problem meaning that if z is not infinity, z is a point on the plane, so z is not infinity, and this also doesn't create a problem, so z is not equal to minus c by d. Yes, D by C. Thank you. Let me have a look at this and write it down. Yes, because otherwise I'll miss some of these things. So C not equal to 0, that's also important. C not equal to 0, Z not equal to infinity, Z not equal to minus D by C. And I define, if z is infinity, then obviously the definition should be a by c, because if you just remove z, then this is a plus b by z, c plus d by z. And if z goes to infinity think of just real numbers, so if z goes to infinity, this goes to 0 and a by c remains, so it should be a by c. So that's a natural definition. But you need a definition. So A by C. If C is still not equal to 0 and Z is infinity. And infinity if C is 0. C is C not equal to 0, Z equal to minus D by C. Now C equal to 0 situation. So if C equal to 0, so we will also put another restriction that A by B is not equal to C by D. Because if that is the case, if these two are equal, then they are equal to some k, then this just amounts to multiplying z by k, yes. So then this is of constant proportion, so it doesn't give you anything rather than just this multiplication by a complex number. So we would assume this condition. So this is infinity. And A by D, if C is 0, B by D, if C is 0 and Z not equal to infinity. And again infinity, if C is 0, Z is infinity. So all these funny things are to take care of the infinity, otherwise this is just a definition. So these are all some limiting cases. So why should we look at such a transformation? So that will be clear from what we do next. So, so I just take a definition. So the definition is, if D is a region, so open connected set, then automorphisms of D this is a set of conformal self maps. Conformal is 1-1 on 2 map it has to be. So now we look at these functions. One question is to calculate these things. So questions. Is to calculate this C and for the So these questions we will try to answer. So this is the open disk. Open unit disk, and this is the upper half plane. So I would define what are they. So we are going to calculate these things. So what are they? So D is the open unit disk. So complex numbers with modulus strictly less than 1, and the upper half plane. So upper half plane is the complex plane above the real line. So excluding the real line, just the upper part. Okay. So what does this Mobius transforms have to do with this this set? Okay. So this is going to this conformal so these conformal 1-1-1-2 maps are going to form a group. So this is a group under composition. So this is a group So this forms a group. So we are going to calculate this group. Okay. So the first step is to prove a theorem like this. So if I have a then so this is a holomorphic map, and it is it is 1-1 and non-2. So then there exist A, B complex numbers A not equal to 0 such that Fz is Az plus B. So we would be calling them conformal automorphism. So such conformal automorphism, so an analytic 1-1 onto map, they are going to be just linear polynomials. They are just going to be linear maps. So I'm little short of time, so maybe I won't prove that. So now we can look at this. Look at the completed complex sphere, this 1-point compactification. So if we look at that, then if I take a map from C hat, and if f infinity is infinity, then the F restricted to the complex plane is an automorphism of the complex plane, because it takes infinity to infinity, so rest of the things, rest of the complex numbers go to complex numbers. So then you can simply use this and say that Fz is Az plus B, and this map also takes infinity to infinity. So I mean that will be the natural extension. So it takes infinity to infinity, and this is the map by the theorem directly. But if it doesn't, so suppose it takes infinity inside the complex plane, so some zeta inside complex plane. Then what I do, I take a map which I take a map which takes these to infinity and then compose. So I take a map like this, and then when I compose, A compose Fz is going to be then this takes infinity to infinity. So then this map takes infinity to infinity, because if this F is going to the F infinity is going to be a complex number, which is this zeta, so denominator becomes 0, so that's an infinity. So this map takes infinity to infinity. And it's also it does belong to this, and it takes infinity to infinity. So we are back to this case. So then this function is of this form, az plus b. So if that is az plus b, so meaning this function is az plus b, so that's going to imply fz is going to be 1 by az plus b plus this zeta, and so this is a zeta z z plus b zeta plus 1 and this. So which is again of that form. So we have a map of this form. So all automorphisms of this complex plane, of this extended complex plane, are going to look like that. These things are automorphisms. These things are conformal automorphisms, and all conformal automorphisms look like this. So this map is onto. So yes, so I would erase this. This we will remember, that this is the disk, and this is the open disk and open unit disk, and this is the upper half plane. Okay. So what I now have is this situation. Okay, so what are these maps? So these maps are simply the action of this group. So if you just let me just define this, GL2C are just the set of the group of 2x2 matrices M2C. With a non-zero determinant, with determinant non-zero. So that is exactly this condition. This is exactly the condition that determinant is non-zero. So what we have done, we have seen that this GL2C maps to this. And this map is on, and this is on. This covers the entire group. Yeah. So this, of course, obviously, these maps are given by this. So if you take a matrix A B C D in GL2C, then A acting on Z, so then this matrix defines this map, exactly this map. So it's already defined. So it just gives exactly this map. So that's how it is defined. So and that's the action. So this is just this AZ. So And we have proved that all these automorphisms are going to look like this. So we have an onto map here. Onto map, onto group homomorphism from this group to this. Though what is the kernel? So that's the question. That's the next question, is what is the kernel? So what is the kernel? So so you can easily see, if you take a complex number lambda, non-zero complex number, so say belonging to this. So this is a set of non-zero complex number. So and then take this lambda into the identity matrix. So then these things are going to give you a trivial automorphism here. So it's just going to give you because this is lambda, this is 0, 0, again lambda. So this is just z goes to z. So that gives you identity map. So and that is precisely the kernel. So the kernel is going to be these things. So C star into identity. That's going to be the kernel. So now we are in a good shape. So we know that C star I is yes. So I have this. So I have this isomorphism. Let's do a little bit more. So so also let's call G is our this GL2 C and say this SL2 C and K is this group. So SL2 C is a subgroup of this group, which is defined by this 2x2 matrices with determinant exactly 1, not just non-zero determinant. Determinant is exactly 1, so that's a group. So that's our H. So what we have proved is G mod K is isomorphic to and now these things. So what is this H intersection K? So H intersection K would be just plus minus identity, because these are identity into a complex number, and if you put the condition that the determinant has to be 1, then the complex number has to be plus minus 1. So this is just plus minus 1. And for anything in G, so anything in G, you can write it like this. Sorry, 1, 0, 0, 1. So this is an element of. So this is just the square root. I'm just scaling every point by square root of the determinant. So when I take the determinant of the resulting matrix, that will be 1. So that's in SL2C. So that's in H. And this part is in K, because this is a non-zero complex number and this is the identity matrix. So this is just in K. So every matrix in G, so this I started with G. So if I take in 2x2 matrix in G, which is GL2C, then we get this decomposition H, and so this decomposition. So every element in G can be written as H and K, a product of an element from H and an element from K, and their intersection is plus minus identity. So what we get is that G is the direct product of these two. So So G is HK. So if G is HK, then I have this. So what is G by K? So G by K is HK by K, which is isomorphic to H by H intersection K. This is our second isomorphism theorem. So that's that has a nice use here. So it's a second. It's the standard second isomorphism theorem. And once you have that, then H is SL2. Sorry. Yeah, that is just plus or minus one. So SL2C is just quotiented by just this plus minus sign. And this is what we call the projective special linear group, PSL2C. Just the name for it. So this is what is called PSL2C. So this is just SL2C plus minus 1. So quotiented by plus minus 1, meaning we don't bother why whether it's positive or negative. We just identify positive and negative, that sort of a thing. So that's called the projective linear. This is called usually special linear group and projective special linear group. So that's what we have done then. So this is that PSL2C. So the automorphisms of this is PSL2C. So we know exactly what the group is. So the Mobius transformations are everything. And not just Mobius transformations, so the special type transformations coming from this PSL2. So you can also take that this determinant is 1, so that then and they are the all. So they are the all, they are all the automorphisms, so that they are coming from the this elements of PSL2C. Okay, I have really very little time. Okay, let me just state the automorphism group for other domains. Yeah, without proving this. So, do we have this? So this is it is slightly more complicated to prove is this. So automorphisms of the disk. So automorphisms of the disk look like this, that if and only if there exist A, B complex numbers the difference of the modular square is 1. Z plus B V bar Z. Yeah, I mean that's just the condition of determinant 1. So V bar. Yes. So this just says that the determinant is 1. So these kind of matrices. So A B. Yeah, so these kind of special matrices in PSL2C, which has this form, so these special kind of matrices will form the automorphism group of the unit disk. And from disk to so and the, this plane to disk and this upper half plane to disk, there is a nice Mobius functions to move from one to another. So what is this function is so if you just picturize it, so if you look at this, so this is our upper half plane without this real line, and here I have this I and here I have minus I. So this is the imaginary axis and the real axis. So what I am going to do, if something is in upper half plane z, then the distance from I is certainly going to be less than the distance from minus I. So that's how this is done. So this map is just z going to z minus I, so z plus I. So for upper half plane, the modulus of this will always be less than 1 and hence inside the disk. And this is called Cayley transformation. So okay, I'll take a little bit of time. So why we are looking at only these things? So there is a very powerful theorem which is called Riemann mapping. So Riemann mapping theorem. So D is simply connected open proper subset of C and choose a point in this D, then there exists a unique 1-to-1 onto analytic map F from D to the disk. This is the unit disk. So these maps are unique by this property. So unique with respect to this property, that this special point what we have chosen here is, so this is just D and this is D with double line. So this goes to 0, the center of the disk. So if you just start by choosing a special point, you can move it to the, you can find a unique map which will move it to the center of the disk, and the derivative at that point would be positive. So it is enough to consider these kind of so this will work for proper subsets of C. So if it is C or C hat, C union infinity, then you have to consider. So that's why we considered C as well as C hat, but this for any other thing which are proper subsets of C, you just need to consider the unit disk. So that's why it's a quite a powerful theorem. It just says that whenever you want to consider this automorphism group, so you just have to focus on the unit disk. It ends now or? Oh. So okay, I'll stop here. So questions? Any questions?